Blasted. Stream disconnected. I don't know where I was. I'll start from the beginning of this page and hopefully. Confounded. I'll give it a minute. Let people rejoin. All right. Apologies for that. My my internet seems to be shitting on me tonight. I'll just start at this page, at the beginning of this page, and we can begin anew. Let's see if I can find a better place. I'll restart the chapter. I'll just restart the chapter. It feels weird to jump in. At 4 o'clock, when again we went on deck, the second mate told me to go on with the punch mat I was making, while Tammy he sent to get out his sinnet. I had the mat slug on the fore side of the mainmast, between it and the after end of the house, and in a few minutes, Tammy brought his sinnet and yarns to the mast and made fast to one of the pins. "What do you think it was, Jessup?" he asked abruptly after a short silence. I looked at him. "What do you think?" I replied. "I don't know what to think," he said. "But I've been feeling that it's something to do with all the rest," and he indicated aloft with his head.
"I've been thinking too," I remarked.
"That is," he inquired.
"Yes," I answered, and told him how the idea had come to me at my dinner, that the strange men's shadows which came aboard might come from that indistinct vessel we had seen down the sea.
"Good Lord!" he exclaimed as he got my meaning, and then, for a little, he stood and thought. "That's where they live, you mean?" he said at last, and paused again.
"Well," I replied, "it can't be the sort of existence we should call life." He nodded doubtfully.
"No," he said, and was silent again.
Presently, he put out an idea that had come to him.
"You think, then, that the vessel has been with us for some time? If we'd only known?" he asked.
"All along," I replied. "I mean, ever since these things started."
"Supposing there are others," he said suddenly.
I looked at him. "If there are," I said, "you can pray to God that they won't stumble across us. It strikes me that whether they're ghosts or not ghosts, they're blood-gutted pirates."
"It seems horrible," he said solemnly, "to be talking seriously like this about, you know, about such things."
"I've tried to stop thinking that way," I told him. "I felt I should go cracked if I didn't. There's damn queer things happen at sea. I know, but this isn't one of them."
"It seems so strange and unreal one moment, doesn't it?" he said. "And the next, you know it's really true. And you can't understand why you didn't always know. And yet, they'd never believe if you told them ashore about it."
"They'd believe if they'd been on this packet in the middle watch this morning," I said. "Besides," I went on, "they don't understand. We didn't. I shall always feel different now when I read about that some packet hasn't been heard of? Tammy stared at me. I've heard some of the old shellbacks talking about things, he said. But I never took them really seriously. Well, I said, I guess we'll have to take this seriously. I wish to God we could go home. We were home.
My God, so do I, he said.
For a good while after that, we both worked on in silence. Presently, he went off on another tack.
Do you think we'll really shorten her down every night before it gets dark? He asked.
Certainly, I replied. They'll never get the men to go aloft at night after what's happened.
But, supposing they ordered us aloft, he began.
Would you go? I interrupted.
No, he said emphatically. I'd jolly well be putting irons first.
That settles it then, I replied. You wouldn't go, nor would anyone else. At this moment, the second mate came along.
Shove that mat in the sand away, you two, he said. Then get your brooms and clear up.
Aye,
sir, we said, and went forward. Jump on the house, Tammy, I said, and let go the other end of this rope, will you?
Right,
he said, and did as I asked him. When he came back, I got him to give me a hand to roll up the mat, which was a very large one. I'll finish stopping it, I said. You go and put your sinnet away.
Wait a minute, he replied, and gathered up a double handful of shakins from the deck.
Underwear I'd been working. Then he ran to the side. Here, I said, don't go dumping those. They'll only float, and the second mate or skipper will be sure to spot them.
Come here, Jessup, he interrupted in a low voice, and taking no notice of what I'd been saying.
I got up off the hatch, well, where I was kneeling. He was staring over the side. What's up? I asked.
For God's sakes, hurry!
He said, and I ran and jumped onto the spar alongside of him.
Look, he said, and pointed with a handful of shakins
right down directly beneath us. Some of the shakins dropped from his hand and blurred in the water, momentarily, so I could not see them. Then, as the ripples cleared away, I saw what he meant.
Two of them, he said, in a voice that was scarcely above a whisper. And there's another out there.
He pointed again with a handful of shakins. There's another a little further aft, I muttered.
Where? He asked.
There, I said and pointed.
That's four, he whispered. Four of them!
I said nothing, but continued to stare. They appeared to me to be a great way down the sea, and quite motionless. Yet, their outlines were somewhat blurred and indistinct. There was no mistaking that they were very like exact, though shadowy, representations of vessels. For some minutes, we watched them, without speaking. At last, Tammy spoke.
They're real, right enough, he said in a low voice.
I don't know, I answered. I mean, we weren't mistaken this morning.
He said.
No, I replied. I never thought we were. Away forward, I heard the second mate returning aft. He came nearer and saw us.
What's up now, you two? He called sharply. This isn't clearing up.
I put out my hand to warn him not to shout and draw the attention of the rest of the men. He took several steps towards me.
What is it? What is it?
He said, with a certain irritability, but in a lower voice. You'd better take a look over the side, sir, I replied. My tone must have given him an inkling that we had discovered something fresh, for at my words, he made one spring and stood on the spar alongside of me.
Look, sir, said Tammy, there's four of them.
The second mate glanced down, saw something, and bent sharply forward.
My God,
I heard him mutter under his breath. After that, for some half minute, he stared without a word.
There are two more out there, sir, I told him, and indicated the place with my finger.
It was a little time before he managed to locate these, and when he did, he gave them only a short glance. Then he got down off the spar and spoke to us.
"Come down off there," he said quickly. "Get your brooms and clear up. Don't say a word. It may be nothing."
He appeared to add that last bit as an afterthought, and we both knew it meant nothing. Then he turned and went swiftly aft.
I expect he's gone to tell the old man," Tammy remarked, as we went forward carrying the mat and his sinnet.
"Hmm," I said, scarcely noticing what he was saying, for I was full of the thought of those four shadowy crafts waiting quietly down there. We got our brooms and went aft. On the way, the second mate and the skipper passed us. They went forward, too, by the forebrace, and got up on the spar. I saw the second point up at the brace, and he appeared to say something about the gear. I guessed that this was done purposely to act as a blind, should any of the other men be looking. Then the old man glanced down over the side in a casual sort of manner. So did the second. A minute or two later, they came aft and went back up onto the poop. I caught a glimpse of the skipper's face as he passed me on his return. He struck me as looking worried, bewildered, perhaps, would be a better word. Both Tammy and I were tremendously keen to have another look, but when we at last got a chance, the sky reflected so much on the water, we could see nothing below. We had just finished sweeping up when four bells went, and we cleared below for tea. Some of the men got chatting while they were grubbing.
"I've heard," remarked Coyne, "as we're going to shorten her down before dark."
"Eh," said old Jasket over his pannikin of tea. Coyne repeated his remark.
"Who says so?" inquired Plummer. "I heard it from the dock," answered Coyne. "He got it from the steward."
"How would he know?" asked Plummer.
"I don't know," said Coyne. I spect he's heard him talking about it arft."
Plummer turned to me.
"Have you heard anything, Jessup?" he inquired.
"What, about shortening down?" I replied.
"Yes," he said. "Weren't there old man talking to you up on the poop this morning?"
"Yes," I answered. "He said something to the second mate about shortening down, but it wasn't to me."
"They are," said Coyne. "Haven't I just said so?"
At that instant, one of the chaps in the other watch poked his head in through the starboard door.
"All hands, shorten sail," he sung out.
At the same moment, the mate's whistle came sharp along the decks. Plummer stood up and reached for his cap.
Well, he said. "It's evident they ain't going to lose no more of us."
Then we went out on deck. It was a dead calm, but all the same, we furled the three royals and then the three t'gallants. After that, we hauled up the main and foresail and stowed them. The crossjack, of course, had been furled some time with the wind being plumb aft. It was while we were up the foresail that the sun went over the edge of the horizon. We had finished stowing the sail out upon the yard, and I was waiting for the others to clear in and let me get off the foot rope. Thus, it happened that having nothing to do for nearly a minute, I stood watching the sun set and saw something that otherwise I should, most probably, have missed. The sun had dipped nearly halfway below the horizon and was showing a great red dome of dull fire. Abruptly, far away on the starboard bow, a faint mist drove up out of the sea. It spread across the face of the sun so that its light shone now as though it came through a dim haze of smoke. Quickly, this mist or haze grew thicker, but at the same time separating and taking strange shapes, so that the red of the sun struck through ruddily between them. Then, as I watched, the weird mistiness collected and shaped and rose into three towers. These became more definite.
and there was something elongated beneath them. The shaping and forming continued, and almost suddenly I saw that the thing had taken on the shape of a great ship. Directly afterwards, I saw that it was moving. It had been broadside onto the sun. Now it was swinging. The bows came round with a stately movement, until the three masts bore in a line. It was heading directly towards us. It grew larger, but yet less distinct. Astern of it, I saw now that the sun had sunk to a mere line of light. Then, in the gathering dusk, it seemed to me that the ship was sinking back into the ocean. The sun went beneath the sea, and the thing I had seen became merged, as it were, into the monotonous grayness of the coming night. A voice came up to me from the rigging. It was the second mate's. He had been up to give us a hand.
"Now then, Jessup," he was saying. "Come along, come along."
I turned quickly and realized that the fellows were nearly all off the yard.
"Aye, aye, sir," I muttered,
and slid in along the foot rope and went down on deck. I felt fresh dazed and frightened. A little later, eight bells went, and, after roll call, I cleared up onto the poop to relieve the wheel. For a while I was stood at the wheel. My mind seemed blank and incapable of receiving impressions. This sensation went after a time, and I realized that there was a great stillness over the sea. There was absolutely no wind, and even the everlasting creak, creak of the gear seemed to ease off at times. At the wheel, there was nothing whatever to do. I might just as well have been forward, smoking the forecastle, down on the main deck. I could see the loom of the lanterns that had been lashed up to the shore poles on the fore and main rigging, yet they showed less than my might. owing to the fact that they had been shaded on their after sides so as not to blind the officer of the watch more than need be. The night had come down strangely dark, and yet of the dark and the stillness in the lanterns I was only conscious in the occasional flashes of comprehension, for now that my mind was working I was thinking chiefly of that queer, vast phantom of mist I had seen rising from the sea and take shape. I kept staring into the night, towards the west, and then, all round me. For naturally, the memory predominated that she had been coming towards us when the darkness came, and it was a pretty disquieting sort of thing to think about. I had such a horrible feeling that something beastly was going to happen any minute. Yet, two bells came and went, and still all was quiet. Strangely quiet, it seemed to me. And, of course, besides the queer, misty vessel I had seen in the west, I was all the time remembering the four shadowy craft lying down in the sea, under our port side. Every time I remembered them, I felt thankful for the lanterns around the main deck, and wondered why none had been put in the mizzen rigging. I wished to goodness that they had, and made up my mind I would speak to the second mate about it, next time he came aft. At the time, he was leaning over the rail across the break of the poop. He was not smoking, as I could tell, for had he been, I should have seen the glow of his pipe, now and then. It was plain to me that he was uneasy. Three times already he had been down onto the main deck, prowling about. I guessed that he had been to look down into the sea for any signs of those four grim craft. I wondered whether they would be visible at night. Suddenly, the timekeeper struck three bells, and the deeper notes of the bell forward answered them. I gave a start. It seemed to me that they had been struck close to my elbow. There was something unaccountably strange in the air that night. Then,
even as the second mate answered the lookout's, "All well." There came the sharp whir and rattle of a running gear on the port side of the main mast. Simultaneously, there was the shrieking of a parrel up the main, and I knew that someone, or something, had let go the main topsail halyards. From aloft, there came the sound of something parting, then the crash of the yard as it ceased falling. The second mate shouted something unintelligible, and jumped for the ladder. From the main deck, there came the sound of running feet, and voices of the watch shouting. Then I caught the skipper's voice. He must have run out on deck through the saloon doorway.
"Come get some more lamps! Get some more lamps!" he was singing out.
Then he swore. He sung out something further. I caught the last two words.
"Carried away," they sounded like.
"No, sir," shouted the second mate. "I don't think so."
A minute of some confusion followed. Then came the thick... came the click of pawls. I could tell that they had taken the halyards to the after capstan. Odd words floated up to me.
"All this water," I heard in the old man's voice.
He appeared to be asking a question.
"Can't say, sir,"
came the second mate's. There was a period of time filled only by the clicking of the pawls and the sounds of the creaking peril and the running gear. Then the second mate's voice came again.
"Seems all right, sir," I heard him say.
I never heard the old man's reply, for in the same moment there came to me a chill of cold breath at my back. I turned sharply and saw something peering over the taffrail. It had eyes that reflected the binnacle light, weirdly, with a frightful, tigerish gleam. But beyond that, I could see nothing with distinctness. For the moment, I just stared. I seemed frozen. It was so close. Then, movement came to me, and I jumped to the binnacle and snatched out the lamp. I twitched around and shone the light towards it. The thing, whatever it was, had come more forward over the rail. But now, before the light, it recoiled with queer, horrible litheness. It slid back and down and out of sight. I have only a confused notion of a wet, glistening something, and two vile eyes. Then I was running, crazy, towards the break of the poop. I sprang down the ladder and missed my footing, and landed on my stern at the bottom. In my left hand, I held the still-burning binnacle lamp. The men were putting away the capstan bars, but at my abrupt appearance, and the yell I gave out at falling, one or two of them fairly ran backwards a short distance in sheer funk, before they realized what it was. From somewhere further forward, the old man and the second mate came running aft.
"What the devil is up now?" sung out the second,
stopping and bending to stare at me.
"What's to do, that you're away from the wheel?"
I stood up and tried to answer him, but was so shaken that I could only stammer.
"There," I stuttered.
"Damnation,"
shouted the second mate angrily. "Get back to the wheel." I hesitated and tried to explain.
Did you damn well hear me?
He sung out.
"Yes, sir, but..."
I began.
"Get back on the poop, Jessup," he said.
I meant to explain when he came up. At the top of the ladder, I stopped. I was not going back alone to the wheel. Down below, I heard the old man speaking.
"What on earth is it now, Mr. Tulipson?" he was saying.
The second mate made no immediate reply, but turned to the men who were evidently crowding near.
"That will do, men," he said, somewhat sharply.
I heard the watch start to go forward. There came a mutter of talk from them. Then the second mate answered the old man. He could not have known that I was near enough to overhear him.
"It's Jessup, sir. He must have seen something, but we mustn't frighten the crowd more than need be."
"No,"
said the skipper's voice. They turned and came up the ladder and ran back a few steps as far as the skylight. I heard the old man speak as they came up.
heard the skipper say.
Very good, sir,
answered the second, and sung out to the timekeeper to bring a couple of lamps. Then the two of them walked aft to where I stood by the skylight.
What are you doing away from the wheel? Asked the old man in a stern voice.
I had collected my wits somewhat by now.
I won't go, sir, till there's a light, I said.
The skipper stamped his foot angrily, but the second mate stepped forward.
Come, Jessup, he exclaimed. This won't do, you know. You'd better go back up to the wheel without further bother.
Wait a minute, said the skipper at this juncture.
What objection do you have to going back up to the wheel, he asked.
I saw something, I said. It was climbing over the taff rail, sir.
Ah, he said, interrupting me with a quick gesture, then abruptly, Sit down, you're all in a shake, man.
I flopped down onto the skylight seat. I was, as he had said, all in a shake, and the binnacle lamp was wobbling in my hand, so the light from it went dancing here and there across the deck.
Now, he went on, just tell us what you saw.
I told them at length, and while I was doing so, the timekeeper brought up the lights and lashed one onto the sheer pole in each rigging.
Shove one under the spanker boom, the old man sung out,
as the boy finished lashing up the other two.
Be smart now.
Aye, aye, sir,
said the prentice, and hurried off.
Now then, remarked the skipper, when this had been done, you needn't be afraid to go back up to the wheel. There's a light over the stern, and the second mate, or myself, will be up there all the time.
I stood up. Thank you, sir, I said, and went aft. I replaced my lamp in the binnacle and took hold of the wheel. Yet, time and again, I glanced behind, and I was very thankful when, a few minutes later, four bells went, and I was relieved. Though the rest of the chaps were forward in the forecastle, I did not go there. I shirked being questioned about my sudden appearance at the foot of the poop ladder, and so I lit my pipe and wandered about the main deck. I did not feel particularly nervous, as there were now two lanterns in each rigging, and a couple standing upon each of the spare topmasts under the bulwarks. Yet, a little after five bells, it seemed to me that I saw a shadowy face peer over the rail, a little abaft of the four lanyards. I snatched up one of the lanterns from off the spar and flashed the light towards it, whereupon there was nothing, only on my mind. More than my sight, I fancy, a queer knowledge remained of a wet, peery eyes. Afterwards, when I thought about them, I felt extra beastly. I knew then how brutal they had been. Inscrutable, you know. Once more, in the same watch, I had a somewhat similar experience. Only, in this instance, it had vanished even before I had time to reach a light. And then came eight bells, and our watch below.
Chapter 15, The Great Ghost Ship. When we were called again at 4:15, the man who roused us out had some queer information.
Toppin's gone, clean vanished, he told us,
as we had begun to turn out.
I never was in such a damned hair-raisin' hooker as this here. It ain't safe to go out into the bloomin' deck, about the bloomin' decks.
Who's gone? Asked Plummer, sitting up suddenly and throwing his legs over his bunk board.
Toppin, one of the prentices, replied the man. We've been hunting all over the bloomin' show.
We're still at it, but we'll never find him, he ended, with a sort of gloomy assurance.
Oh, I don't know, said Coyne. Perhaps he's snoozing somewheres about.
Not him, replied the man.
I tell you, we turned everything upside down. He's not aboard the bloomin' ship.
Where was he when they saw him last? I asked.
Someone
must know something, you know.
Keep in time on the poop, he replied. The old man's nearly shook the life out of the mate and the chap at the wheel, and they say they don't know nothing.
How do you mean? I inquired. How do you mean nothing?
Well, he answered, the youngster was there one minute, and the next thing they knew, he'd gone.
They both swore in black and blue that there wasn't a whisper. He just disappeared off the face of the bloomin' earth. I got down onto my chest and reached for my boots. Before I could speak again, the man was saying something fresh.
See, see here, mates, he went on. If things are just going on like this, I'd like to know where you and me'll be before long.
We'll be in L, said Plummer.
I don't know. I don't know as I like to think about it, said Coin.
We'll have to think about it, replied the man. We've got to think a bloomin' lot about it. I've talked to our side as their game.
Game for what? I asked.
To go and talk straight to the bloomin' captain,
he said, wagging his finger at me. As
it makes tracks for the nearest bloomin' port, and don't you make no bloomin' mistake.
I opened my mouth to tell him that the probability was we should not be able to make it, even if he could get the old man to see the matter from his point of view. Then I remembered that the chap had no idea of the things I had seen, and thought it out. So, instead I said, supposing he won't?
Then we'll have to bloomin' well make him, he replied.
And when you got there, what then?
You'd be jolly well locked up for mutiny.
I'd be sooner locked up, he said. It don't kill you.
There was a murmur of agreement from the others, and then a moment of silence, in which I know the men were thinking. Jaskett's voice broke in.
I never thought at first she was haunted, he commenced,
but Plummer cut in across his speech.
We mustn't hurt anyone, you know, he said. That'd mean, hangin', and they ain't been a bad crowd.
No, assented everyone, including the chap who had come to call us.
All the same, he added, it's got to be up Hellum. It's got to be up Hellum and shove her into the nearest bloomin' port.
Yes, said everyone, and then 8 bells went, and we cleared out on deck. Presently, after roll call, in which there had come a queer, awkward little pause on Toppin's name, Tammy came over to me. The rest of the men had gone forward, and I guess they were talking over mad plans for forcing the skipper's hand and making him put into port. Poor beggars. I was leaning over the port rail by the forebrace lock, staring down into the sea, when Tammy came to me. For perhaps a minute he said nothing. When at last he spoke, it was to say that the shadow vessels had not been there since daylight.
What? I said in some surprise. How do you know?
I woke up when they were searching for Toppin, he replied. I've not been asleep since. I came here right away,
and he began to say something further, but stopped short.
Yes, I said encouragingly.
I didn't know, he began and broke off. He caught my arm. Oh, Jessup, he exclaimed, what's going to be the end of it all? Surely something can be done.
I said nothing. I had a desperate feeling that there was very little we could do to help ourselves.
Can't we do something? He asked and shook my arm. Anything is better than this. We're being murdered.
Still, I said nothing, but stared moodily down into the water. I could plan nothing, though I would get mad, feverish fits of thinking.
Oh, excuse me. Do you hear? He said.
He was almost crying.
Yes, Tammy, I replied, but I don't know. I don't know.
You don't know, he exclaimed. You don't know? Do you mean we're just to give in? Be murdered one after another?
We've done all we can, I replied. I don't know what else we can do, unless we go below and lock ourselves in every night.
That would be better than this, he said. There'll be no one to go below or anything else soon.
But what if it came on to blow, I asked. We'd be having the sticks blown out of her.
What if it came on to blow now, he returned. No one would go aloft. If it were dark, you said yourself. Besides, we couldn't shorten her right down first. I tell you, in a few days there won't be a chap alive aboard this packet unless they jolly well do something.
Don't shout, I warned him. You'll have the old man hearing you.
But the young beggar was wound up and would take no notice.
I will shout, he replied. I want the old man to hear. I've a good mind to go up and tell him.
He started on a fresh tack.
Why don't the men do something, he began. They ought to damn well make the old man put us in the port. They ought to...
For goodness sake, shut up, you little fool, I said. What the good of talking a lot of damned rot like that?
What's the good of talking a lot of damned rot like that? You'll be getting yourself into trouble.
I don't care, he replied. I'm not going to be murdered.
Look here, I said. I told you before that we shouldn't be able to see the land, even if we made it.
You've no proof, he answered. It's only your idea.
Well, I replied, proof or no proof. The skipper would only pile her up if he tried to make the land with things as they are now.
Let him pile her up, he answered. Let him jolly well pile her up. That would be better than staying out here to be pulled overboard or chucked down from aloft.
Look here, Tammy, I began. But just then the second mate sung out for him, and he had to go. When he came back, I had started to walk to and from across the fore side of the main mast. He joined me, and after a minute, he started his wild talk again.
Look here, Tammy, I said once more. It's no use your talking like that, like you've been doing. Things are as they are, and it's no one's fault, and nobody can help it. If you want to talk sensibly, I'll listen. If not, then go and gas to someone else.
With that, I returned to the port side and got up on the spar again, intending to sit on the pin rail and have a bit of a talk with him. Before sitting down, I glanced over into the sea. The action had almost been mechanical, yet, after a few instants, I was in the state of the most intense excitement, and without withdrawing my gaze, I reached out and caught Tammy's arm to attract his attention.
My God, I muttered. Look!
What is it?
What is it?
He asked and bent over the rail beside me. And this is what we saw. A little distance below the surface, there lay a pale-colored, slightly domed disc. It seemed only a few feet down. Below it, We saw quite clearly, after a few moments staring, the shadow of a royal yard, and deeper, the gear and standing rigging of a great mast. Far down among the shadows, I thought, presently, that I could make out the immense, indefinite stretch of vast decks.
My God!
whispered Tammy, and shut up. But presently he gave out a short exclamation, as though an idea had come to him, and got down off the spar, and ran forward onto the forecastle head. He came running back after a short look into the sea, to tell me that there was the truck of another great mast coming up there, a bit off the bow, to within a few feet of the surface of the sea. In the meantime, you know, I had been staring like mad down through the water at the huge, shadowy mass just below me. I had traced out bit by bit, until now I could see clearly the jackstay running along the top of the royal mast, and, you know, the royal itself was set. But, you know, what was getting at me more than anything was a feeling that there was movement down the water there, among the rigging. I thought I could actually see, at times, things moving and glinting faintly and rapidly to and fro in the gear. And once, I was practically certain that something was on the royal yard, moving into the mast, as though, you know, it might have come up the leech of the sail. And this way, I got a beastly feeling that there were things swarming down there. Unconsciously, I must have leant further and further out over the side, staring, and suddenly,
good Lord,
how I yelled. I overbalanced. I made a sweeping grab and caught the fore brace, and with that, I was back in a moment upon the spar. In the same second, almost, it seemed to me that the surface of the water above the submerged truck was broken. And I am sure now I saw something a moment in the air against the ship's side. A short shadow in the air, though I did not realize it at the time. Anyway, the next instant, Tammy gave out an awful scream, and was head downwards over the rail in a second. I had an idea then that he was jumping overboard. I collared him by the waist of the breeches and one knee, and then I had him back down on the deck and sat plump on him, for he was struggling and shouting all the time. And I was so breathless and shaken and gone to mush, I could not have trusted my hands to hold him. You see, I never thought then it was anything but some influence at work on him, and that he was trying to get loose to go over the side. But now I know that I saw the shadow man that had him. Only at the time, I was so mixed up and with the one idea in my head, I was not really able to notice anything properly. But afterwards, I comprehended a bit. You can understand, can't you? What I had seen at the time without taking in. And even now, looking back, I know that the shadow was only like a faint seeing grayness in the daylight against the whiteness of the decks, clinging against Tammy. And there I was, all breathless and sweating, and quivery with my own tumble, sitting on the little screeching beggar, and he fighting like a mad thing, so that I thought I should never hold him. Then I heard the second mate shouting, and there came running feet along the deck. Many hands were pulling and hauling him off me. Hauling to get me off him. "Bloody coward!" sung out someone. "Hold him! Hold him!" I shouted. He'll be overboard!" At that, they seemed to understand that I was not ill-treating the youngster, for they stopped manhandling me and allowed me to rise, while two of them took hold of Tammy and kept him safe. "What's the matter with him?" the second was singing out. "What happened?"
"He's gone off his head, I think," I said.
"What?" asked the second mate, but before I could answer him, Tammy ceased suddenly to struggle and flopped down upon the deck.
"He's fainted," said Plummer, with some sympathy. He looked at me with a puzzled, suspicious air.
"What's happened? What's he been doing?"
Take him aft into the berth," ordered the second mate a bit abruptly. It struck me that he wished to prevent questions. He must have tumbled to the fact that we had seen something about which it would be better not to tell the crowd. Plummer stooped to lift the boy.
"No," said the second mate. "Not you, Plummer. Jessup, you take him."
He turned to the rest of the men.
"That will do,"
he told them, and they went forward, muttering a little. I lifted the boy and carried him aft.
"No need to take him to the berth," said the second mate. "Put him down on the after hatch. I've sent the other lad for some brandy."
When the brandy came, we dosed Tammy and soon brought him around. He sat up with a somewhat dazed air. Otherwise, he seemed quite quiet and sane enough.
"What's up?" he asked. He caught sight of the second mate. "Have I been ill, sir?" he exclaimed.
You're right enough now, youngster," said the second mate. "You've been a bit off. You'd better go and lie down for a bit."
"I'm all right now, sir," replied Tammy. "I don't think."
"You do as you're told," interrupted the second. Don't always have to be told twice. If I want you, I'll send for you."
Tammy stood up and made his way in a rather unsteady fashion into the berth. I fancy he was glad enough to lie down.
"Now then, Jessup," exclaimed the second mate, turning to me. "What's the cause of all this? Out with it, now. Smart!"
I commenced to tell him, but almost directly he put up his hand.
"Hold on a minute," he said. There's the breeze.
He jumped up the port ladder and sung out to the chap at the wheel, then down again.
"Starboard, fore brace," he sung out and turned to me. "You'll have to finish telling me afterwards," he said.
"Aye, aye, sir," I replied, and went down to join the other chaps at the braces. As soon as we were braced sharp up on the port tack, he sent some of the watch up to loose the sails. Then he sung out for me.
"Go on with your yarn now, Jessup," he said.
I told him about the great shadow vessel, and I said something about Tammy. I mean, about my not being sure, about not being sure now whether he had tried to jump overboard. Because, you see, I began to realize that I had seen the shadow, and I remembered the stirring of the water above the submerged truck. But the second did not wait, of course, for any theories, but was away, like a shot, to see for himself. He ran to the side and looked down. I followed and stood beside him. Yet, now that the surface of the water was blurred by the wind, we could see nothing.
"It's no good," he remarked after a minute. "You'd better get away from the rail before any of the others see you. Just be taking those halyards aft to the capstan.
From then until 8 bells, we were hard at work getting the sail upon her. And when at last 8 bells went, I made haste to swallow my breakfast and get asleep. At midday, when we went on deck for the afternoon watch, I ran to the side, but there was no sign of the great shadow ship. All that watch, the second mate kept me working at my paunch mat, and Tammy, he put on to a sinnet, telling me to keep an eye on the youngster. But the boy was right enough, as I scarcely doubted now, you know, though a most unusual thing, he hardly opened his lips the whole afternoon. Then, at 4 o'clock, we went below for tea. At 4 bells, we came on deck again. I found that the light breeze, which had kept us going during the day, had dropped, and we were only just moving. The sun was low down, the sky clear. Once or twice, I glanced across the horizon. It seemed to me that I had caught again the odd quiver in the air that preceded the coming of the mist, and, indeed, on 2 separate occasions, I saw a thin wisp of haze drive up, apparently out of the sea. This was at some little distance on our port beam. Otherwise, all was quiet and peaceful, and though I stared into the water, I could make out no vestige of the great shadow ship down in the sea. It was some little time after 6 bells that the order came from all hands to shorten the sail for the night. We took in the royals into gallants, and then the 3 courses. It was shortly after this that a rumor went around the ship that there was to be no lookout that night after 8 o'clock. This naturally created a good deal of talk among the men, especially as the yarn went that the forecastle doors were to be shut and fastened as soon as it was dark, and that no one was to be allowed on deck.
"Who's going to take the wheel?" asked Plummer. "I suppose they'll have us take 'em as usual," replied one of the men. "One of their officers is bound to be on the poop, so we'll have company."
Apart from these remarks, there was a general opinion that, if it were true, it was a sensible act on the part of the skipper, as one of the men said.
It ain't likely that there'll be any of us missing in the morning if we stays in our bunks all their blessed night.
And soon after this, 8 bells went. That looks like this is the last chapter, so I think we'll be finishing this up tonight. I just need a quick break to stretch, get some water, and rest my voice for a minute. How are we doing? How are we doing in chat? Oh, boy. Mm.
Jesus. This has been an intense story so far. I'm gonna run the bathroom. I'll be right back. I'll see you all in a minute. Final Push, Chapter 16, The Ghost Pirates. At the moment when 8 bells actually went, I was in the forecastle talking to 4 of the other watch. Suddenly, away aft, I heard shouting, and then on the deck overhead came the loud thudding of someone pumping with the capstan bar. Straight away, I heard that and made a run for the port doorway. Along with the 4 other men, we rushed out through the doorway onto the deck. It was getting dusk, but that did not hide from me a terrible and extraordinary sight. All along the port rail, there was a queer, undulating grayness that moved downwards inboard and spread over the decks. As I looked, I found that I saw more clearly in a most extraordinary way, and suddenly all the moving grayness resolved into hundreds of strange men. In the half-light they looked unreal and impossible, as though there had come upon us the inhabitants of some fantastic dream world. My God, I thought I was mad. They swarmed in upon us in a great wave of murderous living shadows. From some of the men who must have been going aft for the roll call, there rose into the evening air a loud, awful shouting. "Aloft!" yelled someone, but as I looked aloft, I saw that the horrible things were swarming there in scores and scores. "Jesus Christ!" shrieked a man's voice, cut short, and my glance dropped from aloft, to find 2 of the men who had come out of the forecastle with me, rolling upon the deck. They were 2 indistinguishable masses that writhed there, and there across the planks. The brutes fairly covered them. From them came muffled little shrieks and gasps, and there I stood, with me were the other 2 men. A man darted past us into the forecastle with 2 gray men on his back, and I heard them kill him. Then, the 2 men by me ran suddenly across the fore hatch and up the starboard ladder onto the forecastle head. Yet, almost in the same instant, I saw several of the gray men disappear up the other ladder. From the forecastle head above, I heard the 2 men commence to shout, and this died away into a loud scuffling. At that, I turned to see whether I could get away. I stared round helplessly, and then, with 2 jumps, I was on the pigsty, and from there upon the top of the deckhouse. I threw myself flat and waited breathlessly. All at once, it seemed to me that it was darker than it had been the previous moment, and I raised my head very cautiously. I saw that the ship was enveloped in a great billows of mist, and then, not 6 feet from me, I made out someone lying face down. It was Tammy. I felt safer now that we were hidden by the mist, and I crawled to him. I gave a quick gasp of terror when I touched him, but when he saw who it was, he started to sob like a little kid. "Hush," I said. "For God's sakes, be quiet." But I need not to have troubled, for the shrieks of the men being killed down the decks all around us drowned every other sound. I knelt up and glanced around and then aloft. Overhead, I could make out dimly the spars and sails, and now, as I looked, I saw that the t'gallants and royals had been unloosed and were hanging in the bunt lines. Almost in the same moment, the terrible crying of the poor beggars from the decks ceased, and there succeeded an awful silence, in which I could distinctly hear Tammy sobbing. I reached out and shook him.
Be quiet, I whispered intensely. They'll hear us.
At my touch and whisper, he struggled to become silent, and then, overhead, I saw the 6 yards being swiftly mastheaded. Scarcely were the sails set when I heard the swish and flicking of gaskets being cast adrift on the lower yards, and realized that the ghostly things were at work there. For a moment or so, there was silence, and I made my way cautiously to the after end of the house and peered over. Yet, because of the mist, I could see nothing. Then, abruptly from behind me, came a single wail of sudden pain and terror from Tammy. It ended instantly in a sort of choke. I stood up in the mist and ran back to where I left the kid, but he had gone. I stood dazed. I felt like shrieking out loud. Above me, I heard the flaps of the course being tumbled off the yards. Down upon the decks, there were other noises of a multitude of working in a weird, inhuman silence. Then came the squeal and rattle of blocks and braces aloft. They were squaring the yards. I remained standing. I watched the yards squared, and then I saw the sails fill suddenly. An instant later, the deck of the house, upon which I stood, became canted forward. The slope increased so that I could scarcely stand, and grabbed at one of the wire winches. I wondered in a stunned sort of way what was happening. Almost directly afterwards, from the deck on the port side of the house, there came a sudden, loud human scream. And immediately, from different parts of the deck, there rose, afresh, some horrible shouts of agony from odd men. This grew into an intense screaming that shook my heart up, and there came again a noise of desperate, brief fighting. Then a breath of cold wind seemed to play in the mist, and I could see down the slope of the deck. I looked below me, towards the bow. The jib boom was plunged right into the water. And, as I stared, the bows disappeared into the sea. The deck of the house became a wall to me, and I was swinging from the winch, which was now above my head. I watched the ocean lap over the edge of the forecastle head, and rush down onto the main deck, roaring into the empty forecastle, and still, all around me, crying of the lost sailor men. I heard something strike the corner of the house above me, with a dull thud. Then I saw Plummer plunge down into the flood beneath. I remembered that he had been at the wheel. The next instant, the water leapt up to my feet. There came a drear chorus of bubbling screams, a roar of waters, and I was going swiftly down into the darkness. I let go of the winch and struck out madly, trying to hold my breath. There was a loud singing in my ears. It grew louder. I opened my mouth. I felt I was dying. And then, thank God, I was at the surface, breathing. For the moment, I was blinded with the water and my agony of breathlessness. Then, growing easier, I brushed the water from my eyes, And so, not 300 yards away, I made out a large ship, floating, almost motionless. At first, I could scarcely believe what I saw aright. Then, as I realized that indeed there was yet a chance of living, I started to swim towards you. And the rest...
And you think, said the captain interrogatively, and stopped short.
No, replied Jessup, I don't think. I know. None of us think. It's a gospel fact. People talk about queer things happening at sea, but this isn't one of them. This is one of the real things. You've all seen queer things, perhaps more than I have. It depends. But they don't go down the log. These kinds of things never do. This one won't, at least, not as it really happened. He nodded his head slowly and went on, addressing the captain more particularly. I'll bet, he said deliberately, that you'll enter it in the logbook something like this. May 18th, latitude, south, longitude, west, 2 p.m. Light winds from the south and east, slightly sighted a full rigged ship on the starboard bow, overhauled her in the first dog watch, signaled her, but received no response. During the second dog watch, she steadily refused to communicate. About 8 bells, it was observed that she seemed to be settling by the head, and a minute later, she foundered suddenly, bows foremost, with all her crew, put out a boat and picked up one of the men, an A.B. by the name of Jessup. He was quite unable to give any explanation of the catastrophe.
And you too, he made a gesture at the first and second mates, will probably sign your names to it, and so will I, and perhaps one of your other A.B.'s.
Then, when we came home, they'll print a report of it in the newspapers, and people will talk about about unseaworthy ships. Maybe some of the experts will talk rot about rivets and defective plates and so on. He laughed cynically, then went on. And you know, when you come to think of it, there's no one except our own selves will ever know how it happened, really. The shellbacks don't count. They're only beastly drunken brutes of common sailors. Poor devils. No one would think of taking anything they said as anything more than a damn cuffer. Besides, the beggars only tell these things when they're half boozed. They wouldn't then, for fear of being laughed at. Only they're not responsible. He broke off and looked round at us. The skipper and the two mates nodded their heads in silent assent.
Appendix. The Silent Ship. I'm the third mate of the Sanger, and the vessel that picked up Jessup, you know. And he's asked us to write a short note of what we saw from our side and sign it. The old man set me on the job. As he says, I can put it better than he can. Well, it was in the first dog watch that we came up with her, the Mort Zestus, I mean. But it was in the second dog watch that it happened. The mate and I were on the poop watching her, you see, and we'd signaled her, and she'd not taken any notice. And that it seemed queer, as we have been more than 300 or 400 yards off her port beam. And it was a fine evening, so that we could almost have had a tea fight, if they'd seemed a pleasant crowd. As it was, we'd called them a set of sulky swine, and left it at that, though we'd still kept our hoist up. All the same, you know, we watched her a lot, and I remember, even then, I thought it queer how quiet she was. We couldn't even hear her bell go, and I spoke to the mate about it, and he said he'd been noticing the same thing. Then, about 6 bells, they shortened her right down to topsails, and I can tell you that made us stare more than ever, as anyone can imagine. And I remember we noticed then, especially, that we couldn't hear a single sound from her, even when the halyards were let go. And,
you know, without the glass, I saw their old man singing out something, but we didn't get a sound of it, and we should have been able to hear every word. Then, just before eight bells, the things Jessup told us about happened. Both the mate and the old man said they could see men going aboard up her side, a bit indistinct, you know, because it was getting dusk. But the second mate and I half thought we did and half thought we didn't. But there was something queer. We all knew that, and it looked like a sort of moving mist along her side. I know I felt pretty funny, but it wasn't the sort of thing, of course, to be too sure and serious about until you were sure. After the mate and the captain said that they saw the men boarding her, we began to hear sounds from her, very queer at first, and rather like a phonograph makes when it's getting up to speed. Then the sounds came properly from her, and we heard them shouting and yelling, you know. I don't even know just what I really thought. It was all so queer and mixed. The next thing I remember, there was a thick mist round the ship, and then all the noise was shut off, as if it were all the other side of a door. But we could still see her mast and spars and sails above the misty stuff, and both the captain and the mate said they could see men aloft, and I thought I could. But the second mate wasn't sure. All the same, though, the sails were all loosed in about a minute, it seemed, and the yards mast-headed. We couldn't see the courses above the mist, but Jessup says they were loosed too, and sheeted home along with the upper sails. Then we saw the yards squared, and I saw the sails fill bang up with wind, and yet, you know, ours were slatting. The next thing was the one that hit me with more than anything. Her mast took a cant forward, and then I saw her stem come up out of the mist that was round her. Then, all in an instant, we could hear sounds from the vessel again, and I tell you, the men didn't seem to be shouting, but screaming. Her stern went higher, and it was most extraordinary to look at, and then she went plunk down, head foremost, right bang into the mist stuff. It was all right what Jessup says, and when we saw him swimming, I was the one who spotted him. We got out a boat quicker than a windjammer ever got out a boat before, I should think. The captain and mate and the second and I are all going to sign this. Signed, William Nostin, Master. J.E.G. Adams, First Mate. Ed Brown, Second Mate. Jack T. Evan, Third Mate. And thus concludes the tragedy of the Mort Zestis and the Ghost Pirates by William Hope Hodgson. I hope you all enjoyed that. Thank you for joining me. I'm gonna call it a night. Yeah. Thank you again, and